Hi, today I am sitting on Chikiyu. I've been invited by my Japanese colleagues to visit their research vessel, which in Japanese means Earth. We are in the Bay of Yokohama. You can see Mount Fuji behind me, and we will talk today about rhythmic sequences, cyclostratigraphy, and orbital tuning. Okay, before we talk about cyclostratigraphy or rhythmic sequences or the vertical stacking of facies, let's talk a little bit about the elephant in the room, Chikiyu. Chikiyu means Earth in Japanese, and it is the largest vessel drilling ship of the IODP. It's an absolute giant ship. It's very easy to get lost on Chikiyu. Chikiyu is designed as a riser vessel. That means that unlike the JOIDES resolution, it's able to drill within overpressured sediments. So it can drill in hydrocarbon-bearing sediments, for instance, just like you would if you were an oil and gas company. But it can also drill through high-pressured zone like fault zone. And that's exactly why Chikiyu was designed as a riser vessel. It's because the Japanese are extremely interested in fault zone, earthquake, and of course, seismic tremors. And Chikiyu can both drill and recover cores, but also deploy observatories, which is a big part of its job, to monitor fault zone in order to hopefully one day be able to predict the next big earthquake. But let's get back to business and think about sediment. And this time, in this lecture, we'll look at their vertical stacking pattern. So what can you say about sediment if you just stand on an outcrop or look at a core, as one would be recovered by Chikiyu, for instance, and you see alternation, even maybe some rhythm in the deposition of the different rocks. So let's find out. And one thing that is immediately apparent is that if you look at the rock record, there is a lot of what is very tempting to call cyclicity. Now, I don't like the term cyclicity because it implies timing. So I prefer using the term rhythmicity, a rhythmic sequence of rock. And look at this example here from Morocco. It's very clear. This is a carbonate example. We have some soft clay followed by hard carbonates. And you can see that we can basically group those packages into rhythmic sequences. So we have the first rhythmic sequence, the second rhythmic sequence, the third rhythmic sequence, etc. So there seems to be an alternation of hard limestone followed by softer limestone grading into hard limestone. And this is not unique to the example in Morocco. Here's another example from the Middle East. This one is from the United Arab Emirates, and you can see me on the picture for scale. What's interesting here is that we see an alternation of carbonates that start with what are mostly fine-grain mudstone rocks, but then end with much coarser grainstone to floatstone. And again, this represents one such rhythmic alternation. And at the top here in red, we have a hard ground, and usually hard ground indicate non-deposition, potentially because of sea level rise. And the reason it's so interesting to look at those cycles here at the outcrop, I said cycle, but really I mean rhythmic sequences, is because the same one can be seen in the Arab formation. The Arab formation is a Jurassic formation in the subsurface. And generally speaking, and this is going to be an important theme here, those succession represent shoaling upward. So they represent essentially filling of accommodation. So if you go back to the previous lectures, that means that these rhythmic alternation seem to represent filling of accommodation, in other words, a normal regression. So that brings us to a very important concept in sequence stratigraphy that relates to the vertical stacking of rock, and so is relevant to introduce in this lecture. It's the concept of parasequences. So what is a parasequence? Well, a parasequence is essentially a sequence of filling of accommodation. So you can see here in this example that we have the parasequence, which can represent several meters to tens of meters. So the scale is variable here. There's not just a given scale. But what's really interesting is that we go from the base of the parasequence, offshore types of deposit. This is a clastic sequence, no longer a carbonate sequence. So we have muddy, borrowed mudstone with distal storm. Then we go into the transition zone here in the middle that contains proximal storm beds with mudstone interbedded with them. And then at the very end, we end up with the foreshore and the shore face, so the beach facies. And all of this represents a shallowing of the system. And what's really crucial for the parasequence, for understanding the parasequence, is that what's on top of a parasequence is a sequence stratigraphic surface, but it's not a sequence boundary. It's a flooding surface. In other words, it's a rise in base level. So you essentially feel accommodation, then you have a flooding surface, so you create accommodation on top of this normal regression, and you can put the next parasequence or the next cycle. You, of course, have different style of parasequence depending on where you are. So here's a different parasequence that represents filling of accommodation from subtidal deposits. So you have sigmoidal cross-bedded sandstones at the very base to intertidal, where you have borrowed mudstone and trough cross lamination sandstone with flazer lenticular bedding in the middle. And then at the top, you end up with supertidal types of deposits, which essentially are borrowed mudstone with roots. So we see that we're getting into the surface here. And at the very top, we're essentially in a swamp because we have evidence of coal. So very different type of succession than the previous one. However, there is one commonality. In both cases, we feel accommodation. And you can see this because at the top, you also have a flooding surface, and the whole thing also represents a shallowing of the environment of deposition.